السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته everyone. بسم الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين ثم ما بعد. Guys, the last couple of weeks I was studying Surah Al-Munafiqun, the 63rd Surah of the Quran. And though it's a very short surah, only 11 ayat, it is the most comprehensive place arguably in the Quran dealing with the subject, a very difficult and painful subject of hypocrisy. There are lots and lots of fascinating things to learn about this surah, but I wanted to take this live cast in particular and share with you the incredible story behind the revelation of this short surah. It has to do with the Prophet's life in Medina when he had already migrated and left the city of Mecca. And it's been a few years now, about 5 years have gone by, that the Prophet ﷺ is in Mecca. Just some things to understand about the political landscape at the time. The Prophet ﷺ and the Muslims have engaged in warfare against the Meccans, who had expelled them or attempted to even kill them twice now. So they met in battle in Badr, and that was fairly successful, actually, you know, overwhelmingly successful for Muslims. And then they engaged yet again in the Battle of Uhud, which didn't go as well. And actually 70 of the most prominent companions of the Prophet ﷺ were martyred in that second Battle of Uhud. The thing of it though is that when they were martyred, and they were fairly demoralized, because even the Quran will say, إِذْ تُسْعِدُونَ وَلَا تَلْوُونَ عَلَىٰ أَحَدٍ وَالرَّسُولُ يَدْعُوكُمْ فِي أُخْرَاكُمْ فَأَثَابَكُمْ غَمًّا بِغَمٍّ. Like when you were climbing up the mount, you know, because the Muslims had to retreat, and you weren't even turning back to look at anyone, and the messenger was left behind calling you from behind you, and you were hit with calamity on top of calamity. So it's a pretty demoralizing state, the Battle of Uhud. Anyhow, we recuperate from it, but word spreads in the region that that the Muslims have suffered a pretty heavy defeat. Now, as a result of that, the Arab tribes, you should know something about the ancient tribes of Arabia. They obviously made their money by trade, but one of the easiest ways to make money is to rob or loot another weak tribe, right? And since word spread that the Muslims have taken a pretty big hit and they're kind of defenseless and they're not doing so well and they just suffered a loss, might be an easy time to maybe us attack them too and make a little bit out of it too. So a tribe named the Children of Mustaliq, Bani Mustaliq, they got the idea that perhaps they should attack the Muslims as well. The Prophet ﷺ gets wind of this and decides that he's going to preempt their attack. As they're preparing their armies and coming at the Muslims, the Prophet ﷺ sends the Muslim armies and goes and involves himself as well. So they go, and along that journey, a few of the hypocrites... Wait, I gotta sneeze. No, okay, I don't. A few of the hypocrites came along. Inshallah. Not inshallah. A few of the hypocrites came along and tried to sabotage that mission, but it went incredibly well. So what happens is, not only do the Muslims win, they take several captives, like hundreds of captives, and the tribe leader's daughter is also taken captive. And when she's taken captive, what does the Prophet ﷺ decide to do? He actually decides to honor her, she accepts Islam, and he marries her. And when he marries her, he gives her a dowry, and the dowry is freeing all the POWs. So all the prisoners of war are freed. They go back and show up. Now their families are crying and they're like, we just lost these people in battle. God knows how they're being treated. And they come back in celebration. The tribe is elated at how they've been treated. Even though this was treatment by the enemy, they never expected it. The entire tribe accepts Islam. Anyhow, that's a little bit about Bani Mustaliq. The Muslims are now heading back from this expedition, even if successful, pretty exhaustive expedition. And they stop by this place where there's a well. And of course, the Muslim army is made of two kinds of soldiers. They're made up of people that had migrated from Mecca, the Muhajirun, the migrants. And it's made up of people who aided those migrants and gave them safe haven in Medina and supported them, the Ansar, the aides. So the migrants and the aides, right? The Muhajirun and the Ansar. So they're at this camp, and there's only one well. And so you can imagine there are long lines to get the water and get the supplies and all of it, right? So one of the migrants, and specifically his name is Jahjah, he's a servant of Umar radiallahu anhu. So he's not only a migrant, he's the servant of a migrant. He was in line at the well, along with another member of the Ansar, the aides, and he was actually a leader of the Ansar. He was, you know, the Khazraj, the biggest tribe of Medina, had 9 different leaders, and he was one of them. So he's a pretty high up guy. So you can imagine, just to put it in our language, there's a servant, a butler, or you know, a janitor, even if you will, sitting next to standing in line next to a governor from another city, right? And they get into some kind of heated argument. Things get overheated, and these two start fighting with each other at the well. And Jahja, the servant, he kicks him. He kicks, the governor. And he gets so offended, the Ansari gets so offended. What does he do? He's going to call backup. So he says, Ya lal Ansar! He made an outcry. Aids, come to my aid. You know, so the people of Medina, basically, this is a Muslim army, but he called upon the Ansar in particular, right? So he says, aids, come to me, help me. The Ansar, come to me. And so there's a huge bunch of like Ansar gathering together towards him. And on the other side, Jahja says, oh yeah, Ya lal Muhajireen. And he calls on the migrants, the Muhajirun, the people of Mecca. It's basically, what they meant to say was, people of Medina, I've been attacked by a guy from Mecca. And he's saying, people of Mecca, I've been attacked by a guy from Medina. So now the Meccan Muslims and the Medinan Muslims are now gathered together, and it's turning into the skirmish and this conflict. The Prophet ﷺ gets wind of this. He hears about this. And when he hears about this, his reaction is, إِنَّهَا كَلِمَةٌ مُنْتِنَا. It is a filthy, disgusting word. And I was, you know, as I get to this story, I'm just baffled by that description by the Prophet ﷺ. Why is this a filthy word? Now, if you ponder back, what did either side say? Either side said, the words they used were muhajirin, migrants, and ansar, the aids. These are terms that are used actually in the Quran. These are words of nobility and honor by which Allah acknowledges the incredible contributions of these two groups. These people left their home, their belongings, their, you know, in some cases their families, everything they knew in life behind because they accepted Islam. Those are the migrants. These people, يُؤْثِرُونَ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ وَلَوْ كَانَ بِهِمْ خَصَاصَةً. The people of Medina give preference to others over themselves. They opened their doors, تَبَوَّأُ الدَّارَ وَالْإِيمَانِ. They settled and opened up their homes and their faith for those who came outside, from outside. And لَا يَجِدُونَ فِي صُدُورِهِمْ حَاجَةً مِمَّا أُوتُوا. They don't find any discomfort or constriction over whatever they've been given, whatever faith they've been given, whatever aid they have to provide. They're constantly at the service of the Prophet ﷺ, so, and the Muslims. So that's their contribution. What I'm trying to get at is, these two names are noble, beautiful words. So why in the world is the Prophet ﷺ saying, this is filthy language? إِنَّهَا كَلِمَةٌ مُنْتِنَا. Why would he say that? He would say that because he's teaching a profound, timeless prophetic lesson. Sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And that lesson is that even if you're doing the work of deen, the work of Islam, and you're doing it and your contributions are either you migrated or you aided, or our contributions could be in the field of education, it could be in the field of spreading awareness of the religion, it could be humanitarian aid, it could be setting up a masjid or a school or whatever it may be. Whatever Islamic work you're doing, usually our work is under some kind of label. Some kind of organizational label, some kind of group label. There's a youth group somewhere, there's a Muslim Students Association somewhere, right? These are all labels. But when these labels, which is meant to be a good thing, when these labels are used to create antagonism, or people self-identify themselves first under these labels and see themselves as someone distinctly different from people that are contributing in some other way under another label, then that same word, even if it's muhajirun or ansar, becomes a filthy word. That becomes a filthy word. I am in charge of Bayyinah Institute. There are other institutes in the world that teach Quran, that teach Arabic, that teach Islam. They're doing the work of deen too. If myself or my colleagues, my co-workers, the volunteers in this organization, the employees of this organization, if they start thinking of themselves in any way superior or in antagonism with another organization, another group, another label, then this word becomes a filthy word. Then this is something very scary for people who serve in the cause of Islam, that they don't fall under that label that the Prophet ﷺ warned about. Anyway, I'll move along with this story. So the Prophet is extremely disturbed by this, and you know, they should have been calling by the name Ya lil Muslimin. You know, call the Muslims for help. Another thing before I go on with this story, two guys were fighting, just two guys at a well, one from Medina, one from Mecca, right? And two people fighting turned into two communities fighting. Our job as communities is not 100 people versus 100 people. Arguments, disagreements, fights, these things happen between two individuals most of the time. And then people gang up behind one and gang up behind the other, and you have to pick a camp, and this sort of mess happens. We have to diffuse and first of all, acknowledge that the problem wasn't between the group of Muhajirun and the group of Ansar, the problem was just within these two. It was just within these two. Man, there's some other stuff coming in my head. Might as well share it with you. The first problem was between the Muhajirun and the Ansar, the people of Mecca and the people of Medina, right? Not a year, not even a year. Months go by, And another skirmish breaks out inside Medina, and that was actually between certain tribe, one tribe of Medina, Aus, and another tribe of Medina, Khazraj. The Muslims actually had tensions even within Medina. You know what I'm trying to get at? You first have an argumentation against another group. And because you're argument prone, and you're supremacy prone, it's not so long later that you have arguments within the same group. And there are splits within a group. And then those splits have further splits. And those splits have further splits. You know, this starts somewhere outside, and it keeps on getting worse and worse and worse. And this is actually considered one of the punishments of Allah on an ummah. One of the punishments of Allah on the nations that believe is that He broke them up into groups. Like, they disagreed and hated each other, and they kept on making splits and splits and splits. May Allah protect this ummah from falling into that. And those of us that have fallen into that, may Allah help us recover and really take pride and acknowledge that our only real identification is ummatan wahida wa nahnu lahu muslimun. You know, we're just one nation, and we are Muslim before Allah. Now, moving along with this story, it's not just the Prophet ﷺ who heard the news. It's a guy named Abdullah bin Ubay. Many of you might not know who he is, so I'll tell you a little bit about this guy, okay? So he was there were two tribes in Medina, Aus and Khazraj, and you could say that there were 9 districts under Khazraj and only 3 districts under Aus. And so those 9 districts had a governor, and the Aus had 3 governors. So altogether 12 governors in Medina. The biggest district belonged, obviously the majority is Khazraj, and the biggest of those districts was under him. So he was the head of the biggest tribe under Khazraj. And therefore he was actually, in a sense, considered the unanimous leader of Medina before the Prophet migrated, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, before Islam. So much so that they decided that they're going to turn Medina into a kingdom, and they shall crown him the king. So they started preparing, inaugural ceremony. A crown was prepared, a throne was prepared, and celebrations were being talked about. And in the midst of all of that, the guy has already won the election. It's just waiting for the inaugural ceremony, right? And he's going to take his position as unanimous king. The Prophet ﷺ decides to migrate to Medina, and as he does, pretty much unanimously, the city decides that the leadership belongs in the hands of the Prophet himself. He's in the governorship position unanimously. So his entire political aspirations collapsed before his eyes because of the coming of Islam 5 years ago. He's hated Islam ever since, but he knew that he can't oppose Islam head on. So he joins the party. He becomes Muslim to be close with the Prophet. You know how they say, keep your enemies close? Keep your friends close, but keep your enemies closer. That's what he did, right? So he joined Islam for dubious reasons, which became later obvious. Even his son actually acknowledged it. His son was actually a sincere believer, Abdullah, the son of Abdullah ibn Ubay. Abdullah ibn Abdullah ibn Ubay. But in any case, so this man tried to harm Muslims in subtle ways every chance he got. Now he was at that excursion, and they were coming back. Abdullah bin Ubay also hears that the Muhajirun and the Ansar, the aides and the migrants, have had a conflict with each other. He sees it as a golden opportunity to take this a lot further, to ignite the fire. He's already seen the spark, might as well turn it into a fire, right? So he calls a bunch of his close friends, and he also gathers as many of the Ansar, the people of Medina, as he can. And he gives them a speech in his own camp. This is not something he did in front of the Prophet separately. So he says words like kafaruna, or nafaruna, katharuna. These people have overpopulated and overrun our city. We feed them, we provide them, we gave them the home. This is what you did. Hadama fa'altum bi anfusikum. This is what you've done to yourselves, people of Medina. We had a perfectly good thing running here. Look at what you brought upon yourselves. First of all, you bring upon yourself this immigrant crisis, and these people that are all living on our welfare, they're feeding off of our checks. Sound familiar? You know? And they're living off of our economy. We're barely getting by ourselves. And on top of that, these people show up, and now they have the audacity to commit crimes against us. Look at how he treated us. You know, these people, they have no decency whatsoever. You know what they remind me of? He says they remind me of the ancient saying of the Arabs: "Sammin kalbak ya'kulka." Fatten, give your dog, give your dog food and fatten him up, and he turns around and bites you and eats you up. So he called the Muhajirun, the migrants from Mecca, he basically called them dogs. And he says, you know what we need to do? We need to do 2 things, guys. First of all, we need to stop giving them charity. We need to stop. You know, when we stop handing out our handouts to these people, watch them disappear. The only reason they're here is because they need our financial support. They're just entitled, you know. And we need to stop giving them these entitlements. When we stop giving them this kind of aid, they'll just disappear on their own. You know, let them go some other place. Let them suck on somebody else's blood. That's basically the idea that he expressed in his speech. That was the first idea. Stop spending. لا تنفقوا على من عند رسول الله حتى ينفضوا. Don't spend on anybody close to Allah's Messenger. These words were particular. You know why? Because he was suggesting that the Prophet ﷺ, the close people to him, or all people from Mecca, like Umar, Abu Bakr, etc., etc., he has no room to get close. Because the closest people to the Prophet ﷺ are the ones that have made the most sacrifices. So he held a grudge against those who were the closest to the Prophet ﷺ. Anyway, so he says, stop spending on them until they disappear and disperse. Then he says that if they don't disperse, if and when we get back to Medina, then the most noble, meaning us, shall expel the most humiliated. That's what we're going to do. Okay, so now I'm almost done with this story. He gives this horrible, a speech that is supposed to ignite hatred, right? And it's supposed to aggravate the community. He does this, and there's a child in the gathering. A child by the name of Zayd ibn Arqam. And this young boy, some argue, is like 9 years old. Now the thing is, I've given a lot of public speeches. When you're in a public speech and you see a 9-year-old kid, you're not paying attention. You're not worried that whether is he listening to everything I'm saying or understanding everything. You know what you're more worried about? I hope he doesn't start talking to his friend out loud or start playing too loud on the iPad he's holding. Or I hope this kid doesn't cry or, you know, disrupt or whatever. We don't really think too much about the children in the audience often. We ignore them. We overlook them. This kid heard everything he said. He's from the Khazraj himself. He ran over to his uncle on the other side of the camp. Told his uncle, Abdullah bin Ubay said this and he said this. His uncle came over to Umar and the Prophet. They were sitting together. And he said, you know, he's saying this. What should we do? And Umar radiallahu anhu, immediate reaction. I know a guy. I know a guy who I can send and they can take him out right now. Now some of you might be bothered by that. That he actually immediately offered that he should be killed. This is actually a matter of military discipline. And it's universal in many ways. When a military is out on a military expedition, anybody within the ranks trying to cause disruption and trying to break the ranks of the military is considered to be doing an act of treason punishable by death. Because while you're still out in the military, you cannot sabotage the forces. This is not a time of peace. It's a high security situation. But the Prophet ﷺ refused that suggestion immediately. He said, كيف يا عمر? How can that be, Umar? People are going to say that Muhammad kills his companions. You know, يَنْ يَقُولَ النَّاسِ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا يَقْتُلُ أَصْحَابَهُ. Muhammad kills his companions. You know, if you study history, you know that Abdullah bin Ubay did way more than this to deserve already to be severely punished, even killed. He's already committed acts of treason and espionage and sabotage way more than this. But the Prophet ﷺ refused to kill him. You know, some people who argue that, you know, in Islam, if you insult, if a Muslim like leaves the religion or attacks or insults the Prophet, that they should be killed. Study the life of Abdullah bin Ubay. How much did he insult the Quran? The Prophet ﷺ, continuously, and the Prophet ﷺ refused to do anything. He refused to. And he left a profound precedence by doing so. He left a precedence that hypocrites shall not be punished like this. Because if he did that, then you know what? We're so quick and immature to call people hypocrites. And if we would, we would actually take the legacy of the Prophet ﷺ, mutilate it, and mutate it, and say, now we can kill these people. You know? That would have created chaos and there would be no civilization in the Ummah. Because everybody twisted and ready to call another a hypocrite would be ready to even kill them. No. That is not the precedent and not the legacy of our beloved Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In any case, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, at least we need to deal with this situation. Abdullah bin Ubay needs to know that I know. So he calls him. He calls him in and Abdullah bin Ubay and his gang, they swear to God, they didn't say anything. What are you talking about? We would never say something like that. You're the messenger of Allah. We swear. We've testified. We're Muslim. How can you accuse a fellow Muslim this way? You know, we would never do such a thing. And they swear and they're like giving a speech to the Prophet instead, like turning it around. And the Prophet ﷺ doesn't say anything. He already knows better, but he doesn't say anything and he lets them go. What's awesome about this story is that there's another version to this story. The version told by Zayd, the boy, himself. Remember, he went and told his uncle, and his uncle went and told the Prophet ﷺ and Umar. Zayd was outside the camp. A little 9-year-old boy told this story, and he says, now in his on his account, he says, I told my uncle that he said, لا تنفقوا على من عند رسول الله حتى ينفضوا. Don't spend on anybody close to Allah's Messenger so that they can disappear until they disappear. And then he also said, لَئِن رَجَعْنَا إِلَى الْمَدِينَةِ لَيُخْرِجَنَّ الْأَعَزُّ مِنْهَا الْأَذَلُ. When we go back to the city, the most noble shall expel the most humiliated. I told my uncle these things. The Prophet ﷺ called Abdullah bin Ubay. Now the boy wasn't inside the room. He wasn't inside the tent. He's outside. He doesn't know what's going on inside. All he knows is Abdullah bin Ubay, who he told on, went in, gave an explanation, walked out scot-free. He's like, the Prophet must have believed him and he didn't believe me. And those were his exact words. فَصَدَّقَهُ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهُ وَسَلَمْ وَكَذَّبَنِي. The Prophet thought he was telling the truth and I was telling a lie. Now we know from another narrator that what was going on inside the room is something entirely different. The Prophet did actually believe him. Umar did consider even punishing him for it. So that's a different story why they didn't punish. But from a boy's point of view, he didn't even get in any trouble. I told on him and he didn't get in trouble. Like, you know how kids tell on someone? Forget it. Allah did, you know, the Prophet didn't even believe me. So he says, Asabani hammun lam yusibni qattu. A sadness hit me that has never hit me before. And I went into my home, فَجَلَسْتْ فِي بَيْتِي. I just sat in my home. Like, this boy is really, really sad. Then this surah was revealed. After all of that, this surah was revealed. 11 ayat, short surah. إِذَا جَاءَكَ الْمُنَافِقُونَ قَالُوا نَشْهَدُ إِنَّكَ لَرَسُولُ اللَّهِ. When hypocrites come to you, they say, we testify you're the messenger of Allah. And Allah knows you're His messenger, but hypocrites are lying. By the 7th and the 8th ayah of this surah, you know what Allah says? Listen. He says, هُمُ الَّذِينَ يَقُولُونَ لَا تُنْفِقُوا عَلَى مَنْ عِنْدَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ حَتَّى يَنْفَضُّوا. They're the ones who in fact say, don't spend on the messenger, on those around the Messenger of Allah until they disperse. The exact words that Zayd the boy had quoted came in the Quran. And then the next ayah, يَقُولُونَ لَئِنْ رَجَعْنَا إِلَى الْمَدِينَةِ لَيُخْرِجَنَّ الْأَعَزُّ مِنْهَا الْأَذَلُ. When we do, if in fact we do go back to Medina, then Allah will, then the most noble shall expel the most humiliated. The Prophet ﷺ receives this revelation, and what does he do? And by the way, the Prophet ﷺ himself doesn't know that Zayd is sad, or that Zayd wasn't believed, but he calls for Zayd. And Zayd comes, and he says, لَقَدْ صَدَّقَكَ اللَّهُ. Allah has proven you to be truthful. Like, when the Quran is recited, it's recited to all the Muslims. Everybody hears it. But the Prophet ﷺ went out of his way to call that young boy and bring him into his personal company and recite the entire Surah Al-Munafiqun to him and then console his heart. And then he told him, Allah has proven you true, as if the Prophet himself is verifying that one of the fundamental goals of this surah was to save the feelings and to safeguard the happiness of this child and to alleviate the sadness of that child. SubhanAllah. This surah is supposed to be about hypocrisy, and it is, but how at the same time it is about caring for kids, like not overlooking their feelings. Even Allah Azza wa Jal didn't do that. Even the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, who's in the middle of a military expedition, who should be reciting and delivering this surah to the far reaches of the entire army, takes the time out to specifically call the child and recite the Quran to him. What an incredible legacy of our Prophet ﷺ, and what a profoundly beautiful story behind this remarkable surah. One last comment that I'll give you before I go, I know it's been long, is that hypocrisy is a very complicated subject. We oversimplify it, and one of the worst things we can do is just call somebody a hypocrite. One of the worst things you can do. The Quran never did it. The Quran doesn't just say, Ya ayyuha alladhina nafaqu, those of you who have become hypocrites. Even when he talks directly to hypocrites, whose speech and their actions conflict with each other, who don't really believe, who complain about the revelation of the Quran, even then he uses the words Alladhina amanu, those who claim to believe. Allah himself chose not to expose them. The Prophet did not expose them. You know, that same person that has now been proven a liar and someone guilty of espionage by the Quran. One day when he finally died, his son, remember I told you he's a good kid, right? He's a Sahabi and he's a sincere believer. Came to the Prophet ﷺ and said, could you pray his funeral prayer? Could you pray his janazah, please? And the Prophet did. The Prophet did pray his janazah. And he actually put his own shirt on him. This is a legacy left by our Messenger ﷺ that we don't judge and label people as we see from the outside. Because Allah Himself, why would we not judge though? It's so, like, the urge to judge is so strong. Because Allah Himself says, فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ مَرَضٌ. In their hearts, there's a disease. A disease that lies inside of the hearts can only be seen by Allah. It cannot be seen by us. May Allah Azza wa Jal protect each and every one of us from hypocrisy. And when we get concerned about hypocrisy, may He make us of those who are only truly, really concerned with their own selves and not passing judgment on others. May Allah Azza wa Jal give us an increasing love and appreciation of His beautiful, beautiful book. Barakallahu li wa lakum. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.